This is the Vancouver2010.com podcast, your window into the Vancouver 2010 Olympic and Paralympic Winter Games. Sports. We have standing skiers, we have sitting skiers, and we have athletes with a visual impairment. And it's not unusual to see a lot of these athletes compete in both cross-country skiing and the biathlon events. And so today we're going to learn about the two.
Biathlon combines cross-country skiing and shooting. An individual race has 5 ski loops and 4 shooting, and for every target missed is 1 minute of penalty. In a sprint format, they do 3 ski loops and 2 shootings and have to do a 150-meter penalty loop for every missed target. Unlike able-bodied, the athletes on the Paranordic scene, they do not carry their rifles. So as a coach, I will hand the rifle to the athlete as they come into the range. And then I will go back and see where they have hit their shots, looking through the scope. And depending on if they how well they do or if they miss a shot, I might make a correction to the rifle to get them onto the target. And then keeping an eye on how fast they're shooting and what the wind is doing and taking into all considerations what's happening. In Paranordic, we use air rifles, and they're not considered firearms in Canada. And it uses air pressure to push the pellet through. So the pellet is about 4.5 millimeters. They shoot the pellet at a target, which is 10 meters away. And the size of the target that they have to hit is 15 millimeters in width.
How difficult is it?
It's very difficult when you're coming in with a heart rate, so we do a lot of training to come in at a racing heart rate. The thing about biathlon is that you have to ski as hard as you can, and then when you come in, you have to calm right down and coordinate your breathing and your heart rate with shooting the pellet at the targets.
Having a guide, I'm able to go all out and train and race at high speeds and have that great deal of trust with my guide.
Left, left, left.
The trails are notorious for having fast downhills and 90 degree and 180 degree turns, and they have to know, even though they've become familiar with the trail by pre-skiing it, exactly when the corner's coming up, or if somebody falls in front of you, you have to let them know quickly, left or right, to avoid a crash.
Here on the mat, I've got the poles under one leg, and it reduces the time in the range considerably by probably 15 to 20 seconds when the athlete actually is able to hold onto their poles, and then when they're completing shooting, they're able to stand up and get their poles on just like an able-bodied athlete. So I'm going to put my headphones on here, and there's a tone that you'll hear as I'm getting onto target. It's a frequency, a tone, a low tone lets us know we're on target, and then as you get closer to bullseye, the frequency increases to an extremely high-pitched sound. It's like a screaming tone, and that's where the athlete knows they're on target and to shoot.
What kind of recognition does the guide get?
We get the same recognition. We get a medal just like the athlete. Because they've determined that it is a team sport.
A guide needs to be 10 or 15% faster than their athlete.
And if it ever comes to the point where I can't, I'll just step out of the way and let her get to the finish line on her own. So hopefully it doesn't happen.
So someone who's never seen this sport before, what do they need to look for? What do they need to know about how it works?
Particularly on this course, the big thing is fitness. And so what you want to be watching for is, over the course of the longer distances, how athletes fade towards the end. I think there's a compactness to perfect technique, and really applying quick power, just so that you get as many full applications of power as you can for as long as possible.
Your technique is like a crunch, followed by your laps, and then triceps, fire your triceps. We can only get so fast in 1 year, you know what I mean? So it takes multiple years to get that speed, you know.
What makes for a good sit ski course?
A good sit ski course is if it flows. Also, too, is not really having any like tight 90 degree turns at the bottom.
I think it kind of ties into that whole part of not thinking. I mean, you get to the part where you're covered an entire lap on the course and you haven't thought about each meter. You've just gotten back to the finish again, or the start, and doing the next lap, and you're like, huh, here I am, and everything's just flowing and you're not analyzing. It's just integrated. I have to stop myself a lot of the times and like actually look, because I get lost in the moment a lot.
Yeah. Every day for me is like a fun day because I'm working on something, I'm doing something different that I've not done the day before. So it's like, and that's what it is. It's just a lot of fun.
To learn more about this sport or for other podcasts, go to Vancouver2010.com.